السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
يا ربي لك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا ما رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا ولك الحمد أبدا 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 فالحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإلى ثمود أخاهم صالحا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره هو أنشأكم من الأرض واستعمركم فيها فاستغفروه ثم توبوا إليه إن ربي قريب مجيب قالوا يا صالح قد كنت فينا مرجوا قبل هذا أتنهانا أن نعبد ما يعبد آباؤنا وإننا لفي شك مما تدعوننا إليه أو تدعونا إليه مريب رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين Inshallah, today's khutbah is about two ayat that belong to Surah Hud. These are the 61st and 62nd ayat of Surah Hud. And some very powerful reflections, I think, that come as a result of a good study of these ayat. These ayat, as you may, even if you don't know Arabic, might have recognized, have to do with the messenger Salih alayhi salam. And many of you know, and some of you need to be reminded, Salih alayhi salam was sent to the nation of Thamud. Thamud, the nation, is named after their great-grandfather, their ancestor, that's how they got their name. Allah mentions this nation a few times in the Quran. This is one of those nations, one of those stories of nations that got destroyed because they didn't pay enough attention and disregarded and ignored their messenger, alayhi salam, Salih. Now, also it's important to know that Salih alayhi salam is one of the few Arab messengers mentioned in the Quran. There are four of them altogether, and he's one of them. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam obviously is the Arab messenger, but besides him there are three others, and one of them is Salih alayhi salam. Now a couple of things about just this nation. It's not a khutbah about that nation itself, it's actually about these ayat. And some things that Salih alayhi salam mentioned to them. But some things you should note about them that Allah Azza wa Jal highlights in particular about the nation of Thamud is that they had some pretty amazing accomplishments. Compared to the rest of the Arab nations that were there, they were actually much more advanced, much more sophisticated. So Allah Azza wa Jal, for example, says, وَبَوَّأَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ تَتَّخِذُونَ مِنْ سُهُولِهَا قُصُورًا. That Allah settled you people, meaning the people of Shu'aib, the people of Salih, the people of Thamud. He settled them in the earth, and bawwa in Arabic actually means to settle you wherever you want. Meaning you got to pick what is the most strategic location, where should we settle, and you settle there. Now most nations, they just, you know, as they come up in history, they have a geographical location, and they don't have the option to just pick up and move wherever they want to go, and set up in a better, more strategic location. In order to do that, you have to engage in war with the people who have a more strategic kind of land. But when Allah says bawwa'a, it actually suggests that Allah gave these people the power, military power, and strength to be able to pick what they want their capital to be, where they want their geographical location to be. So this is bawwa'akum fil ard. Already we learned that they're pretty advanced. تَتَّخِذُونَ مِنْ سُهُولِهَا قُصُورًا. And in the easy pathways of the earth, you actually made, you know, castles for yourself. So Allah doesn't even say they made, you know, when it was easy to build, they built castles. They didn't just build homes. So marvelous architecture is another signature of this nation. They're not just any nation. And if you look at the ancient Arabia, if you study ancient Arabia, you don't find a lot of marvelous architecture. For the most part, these are Bedouin people. And a lot of the Arabian Peninsula was left alone by the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. They didn't mess around with the area because they figured there's nothing there. Some patches of, you know, some patches of green, for the most part it's desert. So especially the land of Hijaz, it was left alone for centuries. Really for centuries. But there are these people in particular, even in that place where there are limited resources, they were able to build entire castles, entire palaces. And then in the mountain regions, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَتَنْحِتُونَ الْجِبَالَ بُيُوتًا. And you carved homes out of mountains. Meaning they had the technology to, first of all, build safe roadways up going up into mountains. And on top of that, to be able to build like entire homes, entire villages on mountains and stable homes. Not just, you know, you put a hut on top of a mountain and a landslide comes and the home goes. But actually they carved mountains. Nahata is used, which actually used to carve the mountains. So the few things I wanted to highlight in the beginning of this khutbah is that this nation of Thamud is sophisticated. They're advanced in their technology, they're advanced militarily, they're also advanced architecturally, technologically, infrastructure-wise. They're pretty good at the stuff that they do. And Allah doesn't necessarily mention these things because they're evil. Allah does not mention that these people were good at these things and having these things must mean that they're bad people. No, no, no. Allah is actually through the mouth of their messenger saying, you people should be thankful. Look at all the gifts Allah has given you. So now let's turn to this ayah. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَإِلَىٰ ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا. That to the nation of Thamud, their brother Salih alayhi salam was sent. And Allah did not say here, رَسُولًا أَوْ رَسُولَهُمْ نَبِيَّهُمْ. He said, أَخَاهُمْ. And this is a signature of the Qur'an for many messengers, that Allah calls the messenger their brother. It's something one has to understand about Arab sociology. In Arab society, calling someone your brother isn't necessarily about being your physical brother, but actually to be concerned citizens of the same land. To be concerned citizens of the same country, you are considered brothers. You are brothers in one nation. Nowadays in modern literature, you find people say things like brothers in arms. Right? That's my brother in battle. This is my brother, my fellow soldier is my brother. Right? So you have that kind of camaraderie, for example. And you have it sometimes in strange places like sororities in college, they call each other brothers. Because they've got this clique sort of thing. But in ancient Arabia, the word brother was used when you share a tribe and you are willing to take the arrow, not the bullet back then, but the arrow or the spear for your brother. You're going to defend his home, he's going to defend your home. You care for each other equally. You're not out to get him, they're not out to get you. When that kind of a sentiment exists, then you call people your brother. Before I even go on, this is something that was there in Arab society before even Islam. And the sad reality is, our deen came. Islam came to refine previous definitions. So now after Islam, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ, right? All you know, believers are brothers. And before this, they used to see each other as brothers because they're from the same village, because they're from the same tribe, because they're in the same army, etc., etc., because they have the same ethnicity. Now we see each other as brothers because we share La ilaha illallah, because we share Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is supposed to be a lot stronger than any tribal affiliation. This is supposed to be a lot stronger than any national affiliation. And the sad reality of it is, sometimes we call people our brother, but our hearts don't feel that way. Our hearts don't feel that when actually the brotherhood that these people in Jahiliyyah showed to each other is a lot better than the brotherhood Muslims show each other. It's a sad reality. In any case, Allah says, أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا. Why? Because messengers were not just there to give people bad news. Messengers did not just come, and you know, if you have a really shallow understanding of the role of messengers, you would think messengers alayhimu salatu wasalam came, they gave a message, people didn't listen, so forget it, let's take these people out, let's destroy them. No, 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 he's their akh. He's concerned about them. He wants to protect them. He's one of them. What we're learning is when the messenger carries the message of Islam, that he's defined as someone who is genuinely concerned for his people. He doesn't hate them because they do shirk. He doesn't hate them because they're kuffar. He doesn't hate them because they're ignorant. Because you can't hate them and call them your brother at the same time. And it's not that Allah Azza wa Jal they call themselves brother, but Allah called him their brother. Allah called him, you know, their brother. There's a reason for that. This is mandated from Allah. Part of carrying the work of the messengers is that you have to go to your nation and you have to think of them as family. If you're going to be able to deliver the message of Islam to them. If you carry hate and animosity and you think of them as less, you think of them as dirty and disgusting and pathetic or whatever else, then you are not ready for the work of the messengers. You're not ready. That's what Quran is saying. So this is the first word, أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا. But what does he say to them? It's a very powerful message. He says, قَالَ يَا قَوْمْ. He says to them, my people. Before he even gave them a lecture, he said, my people. And يَا قَوْمِ, the kasra here is for لِنَفْسِ. You are my people. In other words, Allah already told them, you're my brother, and he goes on to the people. Before he says anything to them, he says, listen guys, you are my people. I worry about you. This is for you, not for me. I'm telling you for your sake, not for my sake. Like Nuh alayhi salam, I'm always reminded, إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. Who do you think I'm warning for? I'm warning for your sake. I'm worried about you. I'm not giving you this lecture because it makes me feel good to tell you that you're going to burn in hell, or you better get your act together, Allah will destroy this nation, or a flood is coming. I don't get joy out of doing that. I'm doing this to save you. I'm doing this because I love you, not because I hate you. So this is Ya Qawmi. And then he says, Ma lakum, what is wrong with you people? I have given you nothing but love. I have given you nothing but a clear message. But something seems to be wrong. You don't seem to be impressed with what I'm asking you to do. And what is he asking them to do? Ma lakum min ilahin ghayruhu. Ma lakum min ilahin ghayruhu. There's no ilah. There's no one to worship and love and devote yourself to other than Allah. You're not going to find anybody else. But then the interesting, unique aspects of the khutbah of Salih alayhi salam to his people begins. And that's really what I wanted to focus on in this khutbah. He says, Huwa ansha'akum min al-ard. He brought you people out of the earth. That's what the English translation says of the ayah. Huwa ansha'akum min al-ard. He brought you people out of the earth. Insha in Arabic includes the meaning of khalaqa, bada'a, to create something, to initiate something. Abda'a, to create something without previous precedent, meaning Allah created human beings like no other creature before. We're unique. We're special. And now insha is not just creating, because Allah didn't say here khalaqakum min al-ardi. He said ansha'akum min al-ardi. Insha is actually to create something and it goes high, tall. And that's both literal and figurative. In other words, he created you with very high standards. Look at the high things you are able to accomplish. Look at the high level of intellect Allah gifted you with. Look at the high level of skill you have with your hands. What are human beings able to do with their hands to this day? What are we able to do with our tongues to this day? What are we able to accomplish with our minds to this day? This is insha. This is not just creation. It's high level creation. It's high, sophisticated creation. Now that's important, isn't it? Because I started this khutbah by saying that this nation in particular, relative to the Arabs, were very sophisticated. So Allah, the Messenger says to them, أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. He brought you up so high from the earth. But he mentions مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. And that's important too. Allah could have just said, He made you high and sophisticated. He made you, created you in a great way. But He mentioned مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. Why? Because the earth is the lowest thing we have. The earth is the lowest thing we have. And actually, in Arabic, when somebody is humiliated, we say, for example, وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Dasa in Arabic, to put something in the dust. Literally, to throw something in the dust. So Allah is telling these people, you are sophisticated and you can do many things, but don't forget where you come from. Don't lose your humility. You come from the earth. Also, because as high as you get, at the end of the day, where are you going back? To the earth. You were made from this earth. Min al-ardi. But then, subhanAllah, one of my favorite expressions in the Quran, He subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْتَعْمَرَكُمْ فِيهَا. Oh my God, this, I love talking to Christians about this one particular part of the ayah. It's so powerful in the Quran. وَاسْتَعْمَرَكُمْ فِيهَا. He wanted you to build the earth. He wanted you to build. Isti'mar. They say in Arabic, عَمِلَ الرَّجُلُ. Let me, I'll take some time explaining the meaning of this word to you. عَمِلَ الرَّجُلُ, they say, عَشَ طَوِيلًا. When they say somebody lived for a long time, they say, عَمِر. Urdu speakers say Umar, but lambi umar hai, right? That's the Arabic expression amira, to have a long life. This is amira. They say amartul kharab also. They say in Arabic, amr is used when you have something broken and you fix it. So there are two meanings of this root. The first, to have something that lasts a long time, like a lifelong, you know, to build something that has lifelong, lasts a lifetime. The second meaning of it is to fix something that was broken. To fix islah, literally to islah, to fix something that was broken. And then the third meaning that comes from it also is imara. They say imara or amara in Arabic when you build a building. Imara is a building. Urdu speakers also know imarat. They change the pronunciation, but it's the same word. Now what's the difference between binaya and imara? Imara in old Arabic is a building that was meant to last. It's not just makeshift, you quickly built it, but it was meant to last a long, long time. Now what does isti'mar mean? Isti'mar in Arabic actually means that Allah put you on this earth, gave you very high intellect, and He wanted you to build this earth. And He wanted you to build things in it that last a long time. Allah wants you to have sustainable cities. He wants you to have advanced technology that uses the resources of the earth, but doesn't deplete them. Allah wants you to build things that don't destroy other things. This is all captured inside isti'mar. It's encapsulated inside isti'mar. A lot of religious worldviews are that either you worry about God, or you worry about building the earth. Either you are people of dunya or you are people of akhirah. You can't be both. Our deen is beautiful. Allah says He made you from the earth, but He put you in the earth, and you are from the earth, and He wants you to use the earth, like He says in another place, you know, وَجَعَلَ فِيهَا أَقْوَاتَهَا. He put the powers of the earth inside it. Allah put the natural resources that you will need inside it. And since the beginning of humanity, everything we've ever needed comes from where? Comes from the earth, the homes we build, the food we eat, the cities we build, the roads we build, the architecture, the infrastructure, the underground, the overground, the technology, all of it comes from the earth. The ingredients have always been here. And Allah says He wants you to build. This is part of fulfilling the purpose of humanity, subhanAllah. Allah wanted human beings to become advanced. Allah wants for us to build better and better buildings. Allah wants for us to build better and better organizations. To build more and more refined. Of course, this is the time to talk about better governments, right? With the government shutdown looming, right? So Allah wants us to have stable government. Actually, He wants this. But what's happening in modern times? A company comes out. It wants to make a lot of money because its biggest ideal is not to build. Its biggest ideal is to make a buck, to make money. Right, so you'll have companies that have regulations in the United States. Oh, you know what? We should open up a secondary location in China or Bangladesh or somewhere where they don't have as many regulations, and then we can pollute their villages. Who cares? But we didn't violate the regulations here. So let's pollute all the lakes in Africa. I mean, somebody do research on coke and where the coke refineries are and what they do to the villages where they set up.
And how entire villages are devastated, children being raised with cancer because of them polluting lakes. This is crazy. But this is not istimar. On the one hand, you're building institutions, multi-billion dollar corporations, but at the same time, you're tearing the earth apart. You're destroying it. That's not istimar. Allah Azza wa Jal in this ayah is saying He wants the human beings to build. There's nothing wrong with having major corporations, big organizations, infrastructure. But if it is at the expense of destroying other infrastructure, He doesn't want it. It has to be istimar. It has to be something that lasts a long time, that's sustainable. And that's the other thing. You know, nowadays we talk about sustainable energy, sustainable infrastructure, water preservation. After all, we're in Texas, we're told, don't use the sprinkler too much. There's a regulation, no pools, no new pool construction. There's a water drought, there's a water shortage. Why is that? Because there's a lack of isti'mar. That is something Allah put inherently in the Qur'an. People who understand the Qur'an will be people of vision that want the world to have that kind of infrastructure. But now, a few minutes left, and I still haven't gotten to the heart of the khutbah, what I actually want to talk to you about. Allah Azza wa Jal says in this ayah, human beings are capable of great things. And everything that they needed, the insha, the high level sophistication they needed to build a great world is already there. Another place in the Qur'an, all the ingredients you need. Because you know, if you're really smart, but you have nothing to work with, you can't build anything. So He made us really smart, and then He put all the things we need on the earth so we can build. So we can make an amazing world. You know what that tells us? That there is no excuse. There is no excuse for any place in the world to not have good, to not have a stable society, a healthy society. We've given up on the Muslim Ummah. I say, oh man, forget it. They're never going to drive in one line. They're always going to, you know, forget the red lights. Look at the pollution. You know, you land in a Muslim airport, a Muslim country airport, you get out for a couple of minutes, you're like, oh, definitely in the Muslim world. You know, you can tell. The only place you get a taste of the Muslim world in America is in the parking lots at the masjid. Because people park like, you know. Because the last thing we do is do things in an organized, systematic way. SubhanAllah. But the key of this ayah is that yes, the world is getting sophisticated and so many Muslims are impressed with the West. So many Muslims are impressed with the skyscrapers in Chicago and in New York City. So many Muslims are impressed with the developing technologies, and they are impressive, no doubt about it. The universities, the roadways, the cities, they are impressive. They are impressive. You go to the airports, they are impressive. You know, we have like, in Muslim countries, we have like one nice airport sometimes, and people go there for Eid. Because it's like the nicest place. So it is impressive to us, no doubt. But you know what? Before Allah's Messenger, Salih alayhi salam, mentioned these impressive infrastructures, which the people of Thamud had. They had the most impressive, you know, technology of their time. Before that, He said to them, you need to worship Allah. And don't turn to anyone other than Allah. Why did He say that? Because if you build a very advanced civilization without Allah, without fear of Allah, without accountability to Allah, then greed will take over and corruption will take over. And you will use your advanced technologies not to bring humanity to a better place, but you will use it to oppress humanity. So some places will look amazing and some places will look terrible. Like one of the most beautiful places you can go, for example, in the United States is Northern California. Beautiful place, Silicon Valley, right? Some of the most expensive real estate in the entire United States. And you go there, and even what a house here in Texas that costs $100,000 costs $1 million over there, easily, right? And even old ones. But you know what? You have this beautiful city, and then they also have Walmart, and they have these big, you know, big box stores. And you wonder, the people who work at Walmart still get the same pay that they get over here. Where do they live? How do they pay their rent? And you'll find such slum, ghetto neighborhoods in Northern California, you won't believe you're in California. You won't believe it. You know why that happens? That kind of unfair wages and putting people in such economic difficulty. And the companies that hire them make billions. And their executives make trillions. I mean, it's ridiculous how much money they make. But the wealth isn't shared. It's not distributed evenly. That kind of oppression, that kind of injustice, this is what our deen keeps us from doing so long as we have taqwa of Allah. A Muslim who owns a multi-billion dollar corporation is going to share the wealth. He's not going to hire people at pathetic wages that they can barely pay their rent. He's not going to do it. He's going to say, my family, you know, if I was in that position, I would want to be paid a more fair wage. I would want to be prepared more fairly. That's actually what Iman in Allah means in these ayat. That's why Allah says, He gave you this infrastructure, فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ. Then make istighfar of Him. Because as you build your businesses, as you build your cities, as you build your governments, corruption will come. And if you're not people of istighfar, corruption will take over. Corruption will take over. And this is the world we live in. Don't be impressed with the technology. Don't be impressed with the infrastructure. These things have been given to previous nations too. And then those nations refused istighfar. And they destroyed themselves. Allah even says, وَمَا ظَلَمُونَ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. They didn't wrong us, they used to wrong their own selves. They used to wrong their own selves. And this is why at the very end, subhanAllah, look at this khutbah of Salih alayhi salam. He says, ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ. Then make tawbah to him. Why? Why does he mention istighfar and then tawbah? What's the benefit of that? When nations become advanced, they start becoming proud. They start believing that all of their advancement is because of them. And then they have also, of course, what you get, like Shah Waliullah Dehelvi called, rahimahullah, disposable income. People have more money. They have more savings. So they have some little bit extra money to do something else with it. They don't just have money just enough to eat the food and pay the rent, you know, and keep the electricity going, but they have some extra money. They're like, what should I do with this money? Oh, you know, there's a concert. There's a game. There's a this, there's a that. Now they start putting money in things that take them away from Allah. And you'll find the entertainment industry booming in societies that get developed. The clubs start coming up. The bars start going up. The movie theaters start getting filled. The movie industry starts skyrocketing. Why does it start skyrocketing? Because people have disposable income. You know, you'll find, you know, half a full flight, quarter people filling a plane, but you always find a full flight to Las Vegas. It's always packed. Barely get a seat. There's a reason. When people are living somewhat above their survival level, then they start putting money in evil things. So Allah says, you need to make tawbah, people. If you're living well, you need to be conscious of tawbah. And no, don't lose hope in Allah. Don't think you're the one who meets your needs. Your job pays the money. You know, you're living in a good place, you're living in one of the fastest growing cities, and you have a job in one of the fastest growing industries, and that's why you're doing okay. Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us through this khutbah of Salih alayhi salam, إِنَّ رَبِّي قَرِيبٌ مُجِيبٌ. My master is near, and he's the one in fact that answers. First of all, don't lose hope in istighfar and tawbah. And second of all of your needs, they are responded to not by you, but from Allah Azza wa Jal. As I leave you, I tell you how when people become so blind, when people become so blind in their life of indulgence, that's what happened to these people. They hear Salih's khutbah and they look at him and they say, he's a young man, Salih alayhi salam. And when he was growing up, he wasn't a prophet. He was one of them. He wasn't a prophet. And they say, man, this guy, this young man, he is going to be a millionaire when he grows up. He comes from a good family. He's going to be the mayor. He's going to be a governor. He's going to run a business. This kid is smart. He's like elite. But look at what he's doing with his life. He's telling us to turn back to Allah, make istighfar. What happened? Bichara Maulvi ban gaya bacha. That's what they said to him. How did they say this to him? They said, قَالُوا يَا صَالِحْ قَدْ كُنْتَ فِينَا مَرْجُوًا. Oh, Salih, we had so many hopes in you. You had so much potential. قَبْلَ هَذَا, before this whole thing, you're telling us to fix our ways and change our corrupt business practices and telling us we should turn back to one God. What are you getting involved in this stuff for? You know how much hopes we had? You could have been the mayor. You could have been the governor. You could have been the best businessman. You're the smartest young man we had. All of our hopes were in you. When you were coming up, we used to look at our sons and daughters and say, our sons, we used to say, man, if you grow up, you should be like Salih. That kid. Ah, if only we had a Salih. Why can't you be more like him? And now look at you. You know why Allah tells us that? Because some very intelligent people in modern society, very, very intelligent young people, turn back to Allah's deen. And when they turn back to Allah's deen, their loved ones, they say, what happened to you? You had so much potential. What do you mean you're going to the masjid? What do you mean you don't want to open up a restaurant with liquor in it? What do you mean? We had all these plans. What happened to our plans? What do you mean it's haram? Where did you get that from? We had so many hopes in you. Look at what you've become. SubhanAllah. You're going to find the story of Salih alayhi salam repeated in the West a lot. A lot. Young man will come and tell his family, I don't want to marry that girl that you think I should marry. She doesn't cover. She likes to go to parties. She does this and that. I'm not into that anymore. I made istighfar. I want a decent girl. I want a girl that respects herself. I want a girl that covers herself properly. I want a girl that doesn't, flirt when she talks to other men. I want a decent girl. And they said, what happened to you? She's so pretty. Marry her. What's wrong? They said yes already. They already, no, I made a stepfather. Oh my God, my son's gone crazy. These mullahs got to him somehow. I don't know what he's been watching on YouTube, but he's changed. And there's a crisis inside the home. And these words come out in Urdu, they come out in Punjabi, they come out in Arabic, in Ammiya, Masriya, in Suri, and they come out in different dialects, they come out in Malay and Indonesian. But in the Quran, the words are, قَدْ كُنْتَ فِينَا مَرْجُوًا. We used to have so much hope in you. What happened to you? قَبْلَ هَذَا. And this transformation, what is Allah telling us? A nation is headed towards destruction, but there have to be some people that rise and say, my people, my nation, we're heading in the wrong direction. We need to come back. The ayah is also teaching us, people who turn to deen, don't deny that we have to build this world. The people, the young people here that have religious sensibilities, you guys shouldn't just be doctors, you should own hospitals. I say you shouldn't just be doctors, you should be running hospitals. You shouldn't just be accountants, you should have accounting firms. You should have 1,000 accountants working for you. But taqwa of Allah comes first, then you do isti'mar. And you run your firms and your executive corporations on ethical principles. Not the kind of corruption you see in your offices. Not that. You bring a new standard out. You create a new standard based on the taqwa of Allah. You become people of istighfar. You go so high up, people want to interview you. Hey, tell us your success story. Why are you so successful? This is what they do with successful people now. And you, the higher you get, the more istighfar you make. You're not more proud. You are more humble before Allah. That's you guys. That's the future we want from our young people. I know I've taken way over my time, so I'll stop here. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal makes us a people of isti'mar truly as He intends it. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal helps our youth internalize and actualize the great potential that they have. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal continues to always inspire us with the blessed words that He's given us in His Quran and the beautiful legacy He's given us in the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Quran al Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al Hakim. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد نقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولا ذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا. Move up as much as you can quickly. There are a lot of people in the back.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
لا إله إلا الله استقيم ويرحمكم الله. Please make sure your cell phones are silent. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون. نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون. نزلا من غفور رحيم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله إنه هو السميع العليم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I just have a really short announcement, inshallah. And that is that, alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, after 3 years of running the full-time Arabic program in Irving, mashallah, at the Dream Program for Bayina, now I can say the most proud accomplishment for our institution is actually the fact that my students are now becoming teachers. And alhamdulillah, their brothers and sisters are starting to teach Arabic now and teach it in a way that I feel is better than I would teach it. So alhamdulillah, this year actually, two programs are coming to your community from two of my top students, mashallah. This is Brother Wasif Khan, who's actually at Hajj right now. He's from Chicago and he's moved here. And he's going to be teaching in a Quranic Arabic program that goes for 7 months. For those of you that are seriously interested in learning Quran part-time, learning the language of the Quran part-time, and really getting somewhere serious with it, then you can commit to it. It's just a couple of nights a week. Inshallah ta'ala, and the schedule, I'll come back inshallah and do a full program about the details of that. And it's going to be held from 7 to 9 p.m. a couple of days in a week. So look for that. You can even look for that online right now at bayina.com. If you look at Student Center, you'll see it. And it's on the bulletin board in the back too. The second program is by Sister Fusaina, who's actually my top graduate from the second year, alhamdulillah. And she's taught now a few times already. And she's actually teaching a sisters-only program. The evening program is brothers and sisters. And the morning program is just mostly for mothers or any sisters that want to attend, inshallah. And it's the same exact schedule, but for a lot of moms, drop the kids off at school, give a couple of hours to Quranic studies, and still have a couple of hours left before you have to pick the children up from school again, that sort of thing. So it's supposed to be for that. And it worked really well in Irving. Actually, we had a lot of moms coming from Plano to the Irving program, so we figured why not move it to Plano this year, inshallah. So I hope to see some good participation from this community into both of those programs. Thank you so much for listening. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Some few very important announcements. Tonight, inshallah, we have Divine Night program. Inshallah, Sheikh Ramadan will be reciting the Quran, and Khalid Abdul Rashid, inshallah, will be there doing the tafsir. So inshallah, we encourage all the brothers and sisters to attend, all the families to attend, and the refreshment will be served after Isha. The second is Eid al-Adha. Inshallah, we'll make arrangement for 3 Salat al-Eid, inshallah, here in the masjid. But the Qurbani meat, we won't be receiving in the masjid.